I would like to invite Dr. Srinivas Jakkinappoyina to talk about the topic on mechanical ventilation COVID-19 patients. Dr. Srinivas is critical care department HOD in the Citizen Specialty Hospital, and he is also the general secretary for the ISPCM of Hyderabad. Welcome, sir.
Yeah. Good evening to all. Thank you, Dr. Ashwati, for your kind introduction. So now we have gone into the how to intubate and extubate this patient. Let's see how can we manage the mechanical ventilation in COVID-19. So we see the data, most of the data coming from China, Italy, France, and US, and we don't have a very robust data from India. Maybe probably we have a good data. And from that experience, almost approximately around 3 to 5% of the patients are admitted into the intensive care unit, of which approximately 50 to 60% patients are either on a NIV, non-invasive ventilation, or an invasive ventilation. Let's quickly see into the data from this ARDS, the one of the first data which has come from Wuhan, and here. The patients, I want to mention specifically about the mortality and pattern, how once a patient goes on to the ARDS, whether a mild to severe ARDS. The patients on a non-invasive ventilation in a patient with a mild to moderate ARDS, the mortality is approximately 60% in these patients. Invasive ventilation in this Wuhan, they have, these are early data. So 5 patients they have put on invasive ventilation, 100% mortality. 1 patient was put on ECMO, there's a 100% mortality here also in Wuhan. So we also have some data from Italy, approximately 1,591 patients. In this, they, when the data was published, there were still the patients who were in the intensive care unit. So total number of patients were approximately around non-invasive ventilation, there are 137 patients. Invasive ventilation is 1,150 patients. And of that, prone ventilation is 240, ECMO is around 5 patients. So they did not give a split of this mortality, but they have shown that non-invasive to invasive ventilation to prone and ECMO, totally the mortality is approximately 61%. They have only calculated the data of approximately 660 patients, because the most of the other patients were already in the hospital. So the mortality is 61%. This includes both NIV and invasive ventilation. This is the data from New York City. No ventilation, but the patients were admitted because of the different reasons, maybe in the respiratory distress. But these patients required only nasal prongs. They were not into the ARDS criteria. The mortality is only 11.7%. But if patients goes on to invasive ventilation, the mortality is approximately around 88%. So huge, these patients, this data, if you see all this data from these patients, if the patient goes from the Chinese study 100% mortality, we don't have a clarity on what is the invasive ventilation from the Italy, and these patients from the New York, we have still have 88. Approximately, if the patient goes into a ventilator and moderate to a severe ARDS, even if you see more than average of 70% to 80% mortality average is seen in these patients who are on a ventilator support. Invasive ventilation. So, a lot of DAD is diffuse alveolar damage. So, we see a lot of ARDS patients, and it's actually a bread and butter of every intensivist. So, this ARDS, when the autopsies were seen in COVID patients, they found a good number of patients are having a diffuse alveolar damage. But this is not universal feature. Okay, they have also seen that they are not having a diffuse alveolar damage. 2013, they have done 50 the autopsies of ARDS patients of a different reasons, viral or bacterial, less than 50% of all ARDS patients had a diffuse alveolar damage at autopsy. So this says that it is not only the, we all know that it is not only the ARDS due to this is heterogeneous, okay, it's a heterogeneous disorder, but these patients who fits into the criteria of the Berlin's criteria, we can call them as a ARDS. So acute onset, by, we all know that acute onset, bilateral infiltrates, PF ratio less than 300 is mild, moderate is 300 to 200, 200 to 100, severe is less than 100. So these type of patients, with rule out the patient with the cardiac problem. But these patients, see, we initially feel that a lot of patients coming to the diffuse infiltrates fitting into the criteria looks like an ARDS. Once we ventilate the patients, they improve very faster. From my experience, any patients coming within 1 week out of the ventilator, maybe you are not dealing with an ARDS, maybe you are dealing with a lung infection and associated cardiac problem and other issues. But atelectasis is not the pure ARDS patients you are treating these patients. So ARDS patient takes time. So similarly, what we see now in, we are seeing more of ARDS patients in COVID patients. And PF ratio less than 150 is a possible ARDS. And 150 to 300, it's a mild to moderate ARDS. No indications for Crohn. So lung protective strategy for any range of PF ratio you need to follow. Optimize this patient in the next 12 to 24 hours with the diuretics or drains or recruitment strategies. If these patients improve, okay, next 12 to 24 hours, as I mentioned, these are called pseudo-ARDS patients. Okay. So they may be having some fluid overload, cardiac dysfunction, and atelectasis involved in these patients. But if patient doesn't improve and the PF ratio less than 150, on lung protective ventilation, these are called diffuse alveolar damage ARDS. They have poor compliance. They have high chances of barotrauma and volume trauma. Non-diffuse alveolar ARDS. So early COVID seems to be like a pseudo ARDS. A lot of people are mentioning that here, lung compliance is normal. And the patient is having happy hypoxia. This is because there might be, there is a but atelectasis, progressive atelectasis, but this may allow rapid recovery with positive pressure used to recruit collapsed alveoli. So there might be a substantial component of atelectasis in this type of patients. So we know the silent hypoxia, they may become a dyspneic, okay? Or they may, dyspneic patients may improve and hypercapnic, and they may, if it is PF ratio, they are not responding, they may go into prone ventilation. Let's look into this. Early ARDS, there are two types of phenotypes. One is L phenotype, is H phenotype. L phenotype. So here, these patients have a high compliance. As Dr. Raja was mentioning, more of vascular problem is in these patients. So here, high compliance. That says that non-aerated tissue is low. Most of the alveoli are aerated. Okay? And there is a low ventilation perfusion. That is, mismatch is high. Ventilation perfusion mismatch. Because there is also a hypoxic, there is a loss of regulation of hypoxic pulmonary vasoconstriction, and also there is a thrombosis happening on the other side of the alveoli, so that here the exchange is difficult in these patients, and VQ mismatch we are seeing. And there is a more of the vascular problem, there is a less of the alveolar damage, the lung weight is low, as if you increase the, there is a nearly normal amount of gas exchange, then as you are increasing the recruitability by putting this patient on a higher PEEP, they are not able to recruit. So low recruitability. If you see on an X-ray, there will be subpleural ground glass opacities are seen. The H type. These L types in the initially can improve into a better, or these can change into a H type. H type is seen in the say regular phenomenon of our ARDS. The low compliance, because there is a lot of non-aerated tissue. The high right to left shunt, because of the non-oxygenated blood is shifted to the left side. And because of the alveolar damage and alveolar fluid, the lung weight is high. And these are the patients who can be a recruitable patients. And if you do a CT scan, it looks almost similar to the severe ARDS. See here the A, you see here the two photographs A and B. Here A is of a L type, where you are seeing only peripheral ground glass opacities. And this is of a B type, this is a H type, which is seen as an ARDS. But if you see the PF ratios, maybe little PF ratio is higher in the L type when compared in the H type of patients. So this is easily reversible L type. So we'll come to the treatment aspect. But what happens is when these patients, when these happy hypoxia patients, that is L type of patients, to avoid for the as these patients are hypoxic, their patients are conscious, well oriented, their respiratory rate increases. Not only the respiratory rate increases, respiratory depth of the tidal volume also increases. So increased respiratory rate and increased depth of the breathing can lead to a patient having a barotrauma, patient induced, self-induced lung injury, himself he is inducing lung injury. So here, if you measure this transpulmonary pressure in this type of patients, the transpulmonary pressure is very high in this type of patients. How do you measure the transpulmonary pressure? We have to put an esophageal probe into this and we have to see the transpulmonary pressure. It's very difficult to put in a L type of patients, as these patients, most of these patients are not on a mechanical ventilation. It's very difficult to place this esophageal catheter. Some suggest that there is a high swings in the CVP is a possibility, and clinical detection happens because the swings in this, so that there is a more pressure changes. So this can cause it's an early indicator of a injury to the lungs. So as the, if you see into the cytokine storm, okay. So why this, the lung is one of the organ, and there is also a lot of other organ injuries like a kidney injury, liver injury, patients are a vascular injury, patients are in shock. So this is the data again from China. Usually in a patients who is in the ARDS patients, in a hypoinflammatory ARDS or hypoinflammatory conditions, ARDS, IL-6 levels are high, approximately average of mean of 282 picogram per ml. And in hyperinflammatory ARDS, it is 1618 picogram per ml. Okay. Cytokine release syndrome is considered if it is the IL-6 levels were more than 10,000 picograms per ml. The Wuhan data says that the interleukin levels were only 25. If you compare this data from the ARDS patients of any other viral or bacterial infection, the IL-6 levels are far and far less than the hypoinflammatory ARDS. So there's only mild inflammation is happening. Then why these organ injuries are happening? The organ injuries because of the virus itself is damaging the tissues, whether the liver or kidney. The recent autopsy found that no renovascular or interstitial inflammation. They found that there is a copious virulence in the renal tissue. So this is, there are a lot of data saying that there's a mild inflammation things in these patients, a lot of organ damage is happening, and it is not that because of the cytokine release, this organ happens. systems. Let's go into the systems. How do we support these patients with the various modalities, mechanical ventilation? I'm not going into the drug therapy. My topic is mechanical ventilation. I'll restrict to it. First, as soon as the patient comes, enters into the ER, put this patient either on a nasal prongs or face mask. These are all whatever we are sharing is the WHO criteria, and we also have an Indian data on these patients. Oxygen or face mask and nasal prongs. The patient's SpO2 is more than 94, they're happy. If it is less than 94, needs to place a put this patient on oxygen 10 to 50 liters per minute, non-breathing mask. Usually our practice now in the critical care medicine is not to put these patients on a high non-oxygen, non-breathing mask, because these patients, when their respiratory rate is high, oxygen saturation is less. Once the patient is not able to maintain the saturation on a face mask or nasal prongs, we directly go on to a HFNC or the non-invasive ventilation. But in these patients, HFNC and NIV, as Dr. Ebenezer has mentioned, there is a lot of aerosol in these patients. So we can try your oxygen 10 to 50 liter non-breathing mask in this type of patients. We don't have much evidence, and probably the data may come soon, that what is the level of toxicity of the lungs if you are using high flow oxygen in this type of patients. But at present, I think we are comfortable treating these patients on a non-breathing mask. HFNC and NIV reassess these patients. If the patients are not able to maintain on a HFNC, you can try on an NIV, but very for short time you have to try on these patients. Not improving, worsening oxygenation, increase in heart rate or respiratory rate, please intubate this patient with a full PPE, as Dr. Ebenezer was mentioning. And I see a lot of discussions at the various forum levels that when you intubate this patient, as I have shown the data, this patient's mortality is high, almost 100% in China, 88% in US. So the recovery rate is good in NIV. So a lot of people are discussing about continue this NIV, drag this NIV. I don't think I should drag this NIV. When the patient is not responding in 1 or 2 hours with an NIV or HFNC, straight away I go for intubation of this patient. Oxygen therapy, the recommendations is try to keep a target more than 94% during the resuscitation phase, and initiate oxygen therapy at 5 liters per minute and titrate flow rates to reach a target of more than 93 during resuscitation. Once patient is stable, target on more than 90% of SpO2 in non-pregnant patients and adults, non-pregnant adults, and 92 to 95% in pregnant patients. This is a special recommendation from WHO. Oxygen droplets or contact applications, nasal prongs, face mask, non-breathing mask, and venturi mask can be used. Recognize severe hypoxemic respiratory failure patient when the patient with respiratory distress is failing to respond to standard therapy, and immediately go on to HFNC or NIV when they are not responding, and go on to a intubation. So, as I already mentioned, that aerosolization is more common in this type of patients. So any patient with hypercapnia, hemodynamic instability, multi-organ failure, abnormal mental status should generally not receive HFNC, and this patient should not be monitored more than 1 hour. If they are not responding, try to intubate this patient. NIV, already we have an existing recommendations on NIV in any severe hypoxia in a respiratory failure. You can try NIV in mild to moderate ARDS, but there is no role of NIV in the severe hypoxemic respiratory failure. So the data from the high failure rate was seen in the MERS-COVID. So this is one of the data which is published in 2020. But this data, the we all know, I specifically looked into the data more on prone ventilation on HFNC and NIV in moderate to severe ARDS, mild to moderate ARDS, especially after the COVID, I started searching. But actually, this is the study which is published in 2020, post-COVID, during COVID. But the data they started collecting from last 1 year, before the COVID, they started this collecting the data. What they used to do is, patient was stable, more than 90% saturation, okay, on with NIV. They put this patient on a HFNC, okay. If they are not NIV, if the SpO2 is they put this patient on HFNC. Patient has a stable SpO2 more than 90. They divide these patients. They put this patient on a prone position on HFNC. So here we have a divided. They have looked into HFNC, HFNC into prone, NIV, NIV in prone ventilation, okay, and intubation. So they tried to compare these four groups of patients, like HFNC, HFNC with prone ventilation, NIV and NIV with prone ventilation. So if HFNC with the prone ventilation, if it is a stable more than 90%, yes, then continue HFNC with prone ventilation. No, then they will be switching to NIV. And if they are stable, then continue on NIV. If they are not stable, then prone ventilation on a NIV. And if they are unstable, intubate this patient. So if the patient is not stable on HFNC, then they are converted into NIV. So then they have looked into the data. Okay, they are looking into the data of PF ratio at the different levels. They found that the HFNC, when the patients are put in HFNC with prone ventilation, the oxygenation has significantly improved when compared with HFNC. NIV and with prone also similarly have increased the increased the oxygenation PF ratio when compared with the NIV. Their duration of prone ventilation were, frequency of duration is around 2.4 plus or minus 1.5. That is approximately around 3 to 4 hours. And the session, one per session was approximately around 2 sessions. That means approximately these patients were on around anywhere between 6 to 8 hours. These patients were on the prone ventilation. They are supine, they're conscious patients. They are in the prone ventilation with the HFNC or a NIV. So the early application of prone with HFNC or NIV, so non-intubated moderate ARDS with SpO2 more than 95%, these avoids intubation in this type of patients. So this efficacy, they mentioned that HFNC, so most efficacy is seen in NIV with prone ventilation. Then next is NIV. Next is HFNC with prone. Then the least is HFNC. So in this also the study, they also has looked into HFNC is stable. They put on prone ventilation with HFNC. If they are not stable, then they have put on NIV. And NIV on prone ventilation, they have looked into these things. So complications. And here, so in our conditions, Indian conditions, these patients, very difficult to place these patients. The patient should be very cooperative. He should not be very much hypoxic. If he is hypoxic, he will not be cooperative. And these type of patients, very difficult to give sedation also in a prone ventilation. These patients may have a cardiac arrest at any time. So this ventilation, I would like to go through this quickly into this. There's no difference in a regular ARDS patient and these type of patients managing intubation, mechanical ventilation, tidal volume 6 to 8, okay, PEEP of 8, and driving pressure, try to keep less than 15, and the respiratory rate adjusts to the ETCO2 around 45 to 50. If no shock, Okay, if SpO2 is less than 90% and FiO2 more than 0.6, PF ratio less than 150. Okay, then try to increase the PEEP by 2 centimeters and you can go up to 15 centimeters of water and you can consider the neuromuscular blockade and also do an echo as soon as possible to rule out the cardiac. What are your targets on the mechanical ventilation? Like a similar targets like ARDS patients, SpO2 90 to 94. And the PaO2 60, okay. PaCO2, see that the pH is more than 7.3, P plateau is less than 28, driving pressure less than 15, and FiO2 less than 0.4. And you will know that whether you can identify this type of patient, whether a L type of pneumonia or a H type of pneumonia. So the prone ventilation, 16 hours, and you can, in a L type of pneumonia, you can increase the tidal volume to 8 ml from 6 ml. And same ventilator settings, you can decrease, you have already started on the 6 ml per kg body weight, you can continue. You can do recruitment, you can do this patient, increase the PEEP. You can go for the high strategy PEEP in these patients of H type. L type, low PEEP strategy can be considered. Low PEEP strategy, so in the ARDS protocol, we have two strategies. One is low PEEP strategies and one is high PEEP strategies. Okay, we need to really think into this because low PEEP doesn't mean that it is a 5 or 6 or 4. You also have a patient who is having a low PEEP strategy, FiO2 is 0.5, you can go up to PEEP of 10. But in this type of L type of pneumonia, PEEP of more than 12, 13, 14, they're not of much use in these patients. Consider ECMO if the patient is suitable candidate. If the ECMO is available, which has to be done in a expert center, and here doing an ECMO in a regular ARDS patient is different from this COVID patients. It will be very challenging in this type of patients because every time you enter, you have to use a full aerosol PPE in this type of patients. Use of unusually low PEEP has been validated and may increase risk of atrial trauma in this type of patient, has been not been validated. Okay, so ECMO, there is no real great data from COVID patients, but we all know that the ECMO from the Eolia trial, and when we have it in a desperate situations, we don't have an options. Steroids, the data on the steroids from the patients from Wuhan data, there is a set of patients who they have shown that the benefit, but they have clearly not mentioned which type of all ARDS, whether a mild, moderate or severe type of ARDS patients used. Even non-ARDS patients also they have used steroids. But I think the data is very clear. The high dose of steroids, the mortality is more in this type of patients. You can use in other reasons, including exacerbation of asthma, or COPD, or septic shock patients. And we need to look into the risk-benefit analysis of these patients. Extubation, I don't want to go in detail. Dr. Ebenezer has already covered in these patients. And you know extubation is a more dangerous thing, as dangerous as intubation. Maybe even more dangerous than intubation, because we don't... Intubation, most of the time, patient will be under our control. Post-extubation, these patients are not under our control. Conclusion, my last slide. Most patients with early COVID fall into the pseudo-ARDS category. Overall, will may cause a transition to diffuse alveolar damage, ARDS. So you can see the swings in the CVP until that, and you can closely monitor the tidal volume in your NIV or patients and the respiratory rate in these patients. Okay, and if these patients can, currently it may be safest to ventilate patients with COVID using traditional strategies used with ARDS. Use of unusually low PEEP has not been validated and may increase the risk of atrial. Thank you all.